Perfect. My name is Kristen Mullen, and welcome. I am an interior designer. I am an unrepentant romantic, and I'm a little bit of a history geek, which makes Bridgerton sort of a perfect fit for me in terms of a topic I'm really, really interested in. So I first found out about Bridgerton, discovered it on social media with just the rave reviews that I was reading, very breathless and, must see. And I have to confess that when I was in high school, reading sort of meaningless Regency novels was sort of my guilty pastime, which was a nice change of pace from my English English classes at the time. So when I tuned into Bridgerton, I thought I knew what to expect. I thought I knew what I was going to see. And I was just so incredibly surprised by what I saw. Because Bridgerton was, is, will be, again, just a visual feast for the senses. And I'm not just talking about Simon, ladies. I'm talking about the show itself. The costume designers and the set designers, just they made a really interesting decision, which was to not attempt to be historically accurate, but instead to bring their vision and their creativity to a period piece. And so the result was just visual confection. And while everybody else was abuzz over, the romantic steamy scenes and the colorblind cast, I just could not take my eyes off of those sets and the scenery. And so the result, I believe, is that artistry and that creativity that came with that Bridgerton set and scenery is something that we are seeing now and will continue to see in the palette and in the motifs and in the rooms themselves. And we're going to see that influence in our homes and in our closets. So let me talk to you a little bit about why I think Bridgerton is going to be part of our culture and zeitgeist, if you will. So do you guys remember, it's probably 10 years ago, maybe a little bit less or more, where mid-century modern just absolutely just swamped our consciousness, right? I mean, you could not swing a dead cat without seeing something relating to mid-century modern, whether it was a dining room or a living room or what have you. And it went from being something that was very niche-y to being something that was just ubiquitous, just everywhere. And at the same time, there was an HBO series, you may have seen it, Mad Men, right? About the advertising executives in the 60s. And the sets and the costumes were really, really amazing. And I think it really inspired people and made them have a real appreciation for that aesthetic. And I'm not sure that how many people kind of tie those two things together, but I definitely do. And so Bridgerton sort of picked up on some things that were already happening, some undercurrents were happening in interior design and home furnishings, and just exploded them. So I wanted to talk a little bit about some of those themes, etc. But before I get going much more, how many of you have actually seen any parts of Bridgerton, whether it's the whole series or some of it? Okay, great. So anyway, let's kind of take you through what the aesthetic, the Bridgerton aesthetic, means for us and how we live in our homes. So, palette. So the Bridgerton set designer, costume designer, came up with these incredible palettes that mix colors in a way that I'm sure are not historically accurate, right? We know that in the Regency era, that the colors aren't what we think they were. We think that they were sort of more dusty and muddy, etc. But it turns out that they were literally dusty and muddy. That they were, the colors actually were dirty. And so as they found in the last couple of decades that actually the colors in history were much more vibrant than we imagined that they were. It's just that when we're seeing them all these centuries later, they're dirty. And so anyway, here we go. So a little bit, so what I've done is I've sort of broken down the palettes by the houses in which they appear. So we've got Bridgerton, and we've got Featherington, and we've got Cliveden. And one of the things that I think is really fun about the series is the interplay between the two families, the Featheringtons and the Bridgertons. And I read somewhere where one commentator likened them to Bridgertons are Chanel, and the Featheringtons are Versace. And then another commentator said, oh, no, the Bridgertons are the Kennedys, and the Featheringtons are the Kardashians. And so take about what you will, but the Bridgerton palette, when we think of sort of English Regency style, we tend to think of just this blue and white, the Wedgwood urn that we see this actually on display here. But what they did was they took that blue and white and then they added in these really beautiful icy shades of lavender and pinks, and they made it much more interesting. And it's a much more playful, whimsical palette, and I think we're kind of ready for that right now. I mean, I think the world's been kind of a really serious place for the last couple of years. And so I think they couldn't possibly have known what it would be when they were coming up with this palette. But if you'll kind of look over here, you can see we put together a little bit of a flat lay with some different colors and patterns and fabrics that we're seeing as being a real manifestation of this palette coming to life in our interior design world. And of course, you know, you can see a classic neoclassical rotunda there, and then obviously the Bridgerton scene. So this is a way of incorporating a more traditional blue and white sort of Bridgerton-esque palette. And since not all the world loves traditional, this is a little bit more playful. It feels a little bit more of the moment. And but again, you've got this palette, and you can see how in a more contemporary, more transitional environment that this palette works really, really well. Featherington. I mean, oh my gosh, look at these colors. I mean, they are just bursting off of the screen. The citrus colors and the vibrancy is just extraordinary. To say that they're happy colors is a little bit of an understatement. I mean, these are just full of joy. And they're colors that are a little bit bigger risk takers, right? I cannot imagine designing an entire home in these colors. I can imagine designing a room or two in them and having my clients be very, very happy with them. Whereas on the other hand, Bridgerton, yes, I can see using that palette sort of throughout the house. But wow, what an impact this is, right? And vibrant, happy, and very unexpected. So that really great acid green, I think it feels new and fresh. And you can see it here in a couple of interiors again. This one is a bit more traditional, and this one over my left shoulder feels a little bit more contemporary. But just take a minute also to notice the two lanterns, which also feel very Regency-esque. And I can tell you more about why that is in a minute. And look at this. So this was a room that was done at the Kips Bay Show House here in Dallas in a few months ago. And this was a showstopper. And the palette of it is very Featherington-esque, if you will. And you can see how it that more contemporary, more modern sensibility is in play here. Okay. All right. So we got Simon here. My husband's in the audience. He's just going to have to excuse us while we all kind of take a minute. So this is what we're calling the Clive palette, which was the home that Daphne and Simon shared. And what I think is really fascinating about this palette, and it's actually the one that I kind of love the most, to be honest, is the juxtaposition of this really deep, dusky, moody colors with the brighter, paler pastels. And I'm sure in some symbolic sense, they intended for it to be, you know, the moodiness of Simon, you know, combined with the naivete and innocence of Daphne. But in any case, it is a very, very striking palette. And you can see that in fashion, it's making an appearance. Certainly here at the museum, I love this floral arrangement where you can see those colors blended together. And then we created sort of a flat line mood board here where you can see, you know, you have the bright palette that then is mixed in with the darker, plumier tones. And then as well, sort of the richer palette here that is brightened with the pastels. I do think you're going to see a lot more of this. It's a very sophisticated palette, and I think we'll be seeing it in fashion as well as home. And one last look at Simon. Okay, here we go. All right, yeah, so seeing a lot of lacquer and a lot of dark, yummy colors in lacquer. And so this is a fantastic little butler's pantry area, and then I love, again, the juxtaposition of the lighter colors against those dark and moody tones. And again, this is very, obviously very bright, but again, you can sort of see that palette at play. Feels very contemporary, feels very fresh. So it's not the kind of thing where if you want to incorporate these palettes in your home, that you need to feel constrained because they're not traditional. Yes, the desk is very traditional, but there are many contemporary elements there, and you can see how that would work. Motifs. Okay, so Bridgerton is full of all these symbolic nods to you to kind of help you. They're almost like little Easter eggs, if you will, to sort of help you through the story. And so we're going to talk about a little bit about that. Okay, so nature. Right up here, you can see the bumblebee, and that's on the Bridgerton door knocker. It's the opening shot of the series and the closing shot of the series. And so the bee is sort of the Bridgerton badge, if you will. And then over here, you've got the feathery ten entryway, and if you look really closely, you can see all these butterflies. So again, I'm sure that they're there because the writers and the designers wanted to send a message with those. Like the bee is, you know, industrious and reliable and hardworking, and the butterfly is, you know, more fanciful and flighty. And they wanted to just sort of draw that distinction, that contrast with the two families, which is kind of fun. I think we're gonna see bees and butterflies on everything, absolutely everything, whether it's in furniture or in fashion. But nature in general, you do see in the different Bridgerton rooms, a lot of floral inspired motifs and a lot of nature inspired motifs. And so you can see that we've incorporated that here. And then this wonderful piece here is from the museum. And again, it sort of has that wonderful, the birds and the flowers. And then this is a fantastic serving piece that we spotted in the galleries that again has that nature motif to it. For furnishings, the armchairs above us have the bee on the upholstery, But it's the Napoleonic beat, which is kind of interesting because during the time of the English Regency, you know, England had been at war with France, and so it's kind of ironic that that Napoleon's emblem, which you know, was this bee in the wreath, would make its way known into Britain. But you can also see this really fun nature-inspired dolphin, the twin dolphins, and with all the leaves, the fluting and the acanthus leaves right here. Again, just a really exuberant expression of nature in their decor. And then here, this is more modern, obviously. This is today. And so I believe this is a Degourney wallpaper that's on the walls, but again, it's just that joyful expression of nature. And then again, that citrus palette that I was talking to you about. Okay, a couple other images. These feel a little bit more restrained in a certain way, but the, again, you see the nature with this wonderful Swedish inspired wallpaper here, and the florals of the curtains, and even on this wonderful little bone inlaid bench, which we'll kind of talk about that in a minute. That I believe is from India or maybe Sri Lanka. And then here again, much more classic. You've got a Gracie panel here, and then these wonderful little botanicals here. So this kind of gives you a sense of what is coming in our homes. And yeah, so I could probably talk about this motif for the entire 30 minutes tonight, but I'm not going to. So neoclassical, this really gets to my history geek aspect of things. So at the time of the Regency, there were some really incredible archaeological finds that had occurred. So they were doing excavations at Pompeii, and in Bath, they were doing excavations at the Roman baths. In Egypt, the Rosetta Stone had been found, and they were doing more archaeological exploration there. So antiquity was very much a part of current events, if you will. And so because of that, it was a really big part of their popular culture, and they were very influenced by the elements and the motifs that they saw. Sphinxes from Egypt, Greek keys from Greece, Roman elements, aspects of mythological creatures, etc. And then, to top it off, and maybe even more importantly, was that at that time, in the aristocracy, a way for a gentleman, ladies, not so much for us, but a way for a gentleman to complete his education would be for him to go on what was called the Grand Tour. And it typically included seeing ancient sites in both Italy and in Greece. And so they would come back from their travels, and they would be inspired by what they had seen. The beautiful fluting, the columns, Greek key patterns, etc., all of the mythological sculpture, etc. And so the furnishings reflected those things that were happening, both from the popular culture side of things, as well as from the travels that many people were taking at the time. So you see, you know, the Greek key, the mythological clock, the intaglio here, which was their version of sort of like a postcard. They used to collect these at the different sites, and they would put them in a frame and display them in the same way that, I don't know, now we would just show them an iPhone shared photo album of our last trip, and wonderful gilding, etc. And of course, we have a queen sitting in splendor here with the fluting of the columns behind her, etc. Okay, so this is today, right? This is a cleaner, brighter, lighter version of that neoclassical design. This still has a more traditional feeling to it. Like, you can see the sphinxes. I don't know if you can see it here, on the armchairs and the floating here, and then that great bench both here and here. This feels like a little bit more of a modern version. We called our presentation The Art of the Swoon. I think you could probably do that here or here if you wanted to. In any case, this is a more modern, clean version of the look, where neoclassical elements have been included, but there is still a lot of modernity in this image. So, and that was also at the Kip Space Show House, which was really pretty fantastic. All right, we are having a little trouble getting to the next slide. TJ? Hello? So this is some wonderful neoclassical furniture. Again, the pieces on the left are more true authentic Regency pieces. Pieces on the right are our modern interpretation of them. There's a little bit less fussiness to them, maybe a little bit more heft. And again, you know, really fun. I can't imagine us sitting on these chairs right now, but I can imagine us sitting on this or this. Okay, chinoiserie. So chinoiserie was already really becoming popular with interior design even before Bridgerton hit. We were starting to see a lot of things that were inspired by China, the Far East, etc. But in Regency England, they didn't really think of it that way. They didn't think about that's coming from China, that's coming from Japan. What they thought about is that's coming from the Orient or the East. And the East India Company was making boatloads of cash at the time. And they were trading with India as well as aspects of the Far East. So to them, the East was just this big monolith. It included Turkey, it included India, it included China and Japan and Thailand, etc. What they knew was it was just this romanticized, fantastical place. And so when the Prince Regent commissioned the Brighton Pavilion, They did a really crazy thing, which in our modern day, we like to be sort of authentic to the source. Well, at the time, they had no care for that. So the exterior of the Brighton Pavilion, if you've seen it, it looks like it came out of India, only like kind of a puffed up version of India. Lots and lots of, it was like Taj Mahal-esque, or it is Taj Mahal-esque. And so you think you know what you're going to see when you walk into the Brighton Pavilion. When I visited the Brighton Pavilion, I was blown away by the interiors because they're not even remotely related to India or the Middle East or anything mughal architecture at all. They are all very, very, very Chinese. Or I should say, they were the British ideal of what a Chinese interior would be. So there are these very whimsical, fantastical interiors. And so so that whole influence of the East, we call it chinoiserie, but the idea and romanticism of the East really captured the attention of the people at this time. And so you can see it in what they were inspired by. Now, you know, you can see how we have taken that idea and brought it into modernity now. So this was a wonderful installation that was done at the Kip Space Show House in Dallas. You've got this sort of softer version of it here and some wonderful fabrics out of a French fabric house. Wonderful little chinoiserie mirror. And then this really kind of fun modern take on it here. Two rooms, modern, that sort of exemplify how the chinoiserie style can really be interpreted in in a much more modernist way on this slide here, or much more traditional, much more romantic and loose in this style here. Okay, these are some elements of chinoiserie that are really fun. Again, these pieces here on the left, first dibs, you know, they're true Regency pieces of the period. And then you see other pieces that are more inspired by the fun little pagoda lamp, this wonderful little bamboo etagé, fun lantern, and of course this chinoiserie piece that feels very, very wow. So, okay, so the last thing I'm gonna talk about is rooms. And you might ask yourself, what in the world Regency England and how they use their rooms has to do with us? And it's a good question. If you were a member of the aristocracy, your house was huge. You had a lot of people who you hired to take care of your every whim. We don't have that now, thank goodness. And so, how do these rooms really relate to our lifestyle now? So, I'm going to first talk about the kitchen, the scullery. So, in Regency England, they were called the kitchens, and it was plural because there was more than one room that was devoted to the preparation of meals. And so they would have at least two rooms, one of which was where kind of all of the, to borrow a British phrase, grotty sort of things happened, right? It's where you were slicing the raw chicken and peeling the vegetables and doing sort of the messier tasks. It's where you were washing up, etc. And then the other room might be where the actual cooking happened. And so what I am seeing now is that we are trying to bifurcate the kitchen, really create two, if you will, in modern times, again, so that the yuckier aspects of preparing food, etc., happen kind of behind the scenes. And the more communal parts of cooking and preparing food and eating food happen in a different place. And that's because we're doing much more with open living concepts, right? So this allows a host or a hostess to feel very comfortable cooking, etc., when there are guests there, kind of knowing that there's that back area where the yucko stuff can happen. And so in any case, and I love this scene, how helpless they are. They both are going down to make hot milk, and neither one of them knows how to even heat up the milk. They don't even know how to deal with the stove. So in any case, fortunately, I think we're all able to take way better care of ourselves, but beautiful nonetheless. Okay. So this is just a modern version of a scullery or a back kitchen or a caterer's kitchen. And, you know, beautifully styled, we all know that, you know, in use, it's all gonna be covered with, you know, vegetable peelings and whatnot. But it's a great idea. And I think that we'll see more and more of it. The study, okay. First of all, this guy, I love him. We found him up in the galleries. He looks like he's really on the verge of a fantastic idea, doesn't he? But the Victorians, at least in the aristocracy, the gentlemen and gentlewomen, but mostly gentlemen, because let's be honest, did the bulk of their work from home. That was the norm. And so their studies are where they work from home. And so they were not these grand, beautiful libraries where, you know, everything was all in its place. They were working rooms where there were papers out and you know, you could see, you know, the desks were full and things were happening. They were reviewing their books, they were going over things with their bookkeepers, etc. But they were also really communal rooms in the sense that we're not going into your study and you're going to be there all by yourself and shut yourself off from the rest of the household. No, you were going to be there, and there was seating there, and there was, you know, you could get beverages there and refreshments there, etc. So people could come in, they could chat with you, and you could do your business, but you could also take a break and take a moment and go and sit in a chair and chat with whomever it was that was coming into your study. And so, Okay, so here's what I figured out about studies and interior designers and like what's happening now, right? So everybody in the pandemic is talking about working from home. And we do desperately need places to work from home that are that we can shut off and concentrate in our homes. But we don't, most of us have the luxury of having a single room where we're just gonna go and shut the door and we're gonna shut ourselves off completely from the rest of the family. And that's where we can just be. And that's that room and that's its only purpose. So one of the things that I discovered when I was doing some research for this slideshow is that interior designers hate doing studies. I had no idea. I mean, I'll say they're not very, they used to not be very inspiring for me because they tended to be this sort of dark, dour place, typically a man's study, not very interesting, you know, dark stain, etc. And studies tended to take two forms. One is a dark place where there are a lot of books and a desk and a chair and, you know, end of story. Or, and typically were not much work got done. Or studies were an absolute disaster because people have their papers everywhere and their folders and et cetera. They're not very photogenic. And so I think what we're seeing now is that studies are being combined much more so with other seating options, et cetera, so other people can come in and chat with a person while they're working from home. Person working from home can take a nap if they want to. There may be, you know, maybe the work from home situation is combined with maybe a formal living room that isn't used that frequently or what have you, but it is definitely a dual function room. And I'm really excited about that. I think it's gonna be something that's gonna make our lives collectively a lot easier. Al fresco. So in Bridgerton, they had these amazing garden parties, right? They would sort of pick up all of their furniture and they would go and have these extraordinary balls, etc. And of course, again, because they had servants to do that for them, and they didn't have outdoor furniture the way that we do, they were able to create these amazing environments. And you know, laying out blankets and pillows and all the rest of it, and it was very sumptuous and luxurious. Okay, so we can't do that. I mean, well, most of us can't. But what we can do is really leverage our outdoor spaces in a way that is fresh and different, particularly because of the pandemic. I think we've all discovered that being outdoors is a great place for us to spend time with friends and family. And so you can see that this really wonderful, you know, this is a much more modern setup, but again, it feels very lush and it feels very approachable and doable. And so I expect that we will be using our yards much more than we did prior to the pandemic and prior to Bridgerton. Okay, another couple of great settings. Love the fact that over here we've got a really intimate little seating area. So many of us have, if we're gonna have outdoor dining, we have this huge long table and it only really gets function when we have a whole bunch of people over. I think this is sort of more fun for daily life, going out and having a cup of coffee with your partner or your spouse. And then this, I just think is really enchanting. It's got these great seating areas, a wonderful water feature in the background to sort of feel very peaceful. And again, it feels like a room in and of itself. So So I think it's a pretty amazing place to spend the day, either the beginning or the end of your day. And that, oops, sorry, took it back. Okay, so we featured some wonderful photos from some wonderful designers, and they are here. And then this is who I am. And then the last thing is questions. So please feel free to ask me anything. I know a lot about the era. I know a lot about interior design, but I also spend a lot of time watching Bridgerton. So you can even ask me what you think is going to happen. I think it's going to happen in season 2. So anyway, I'm open.